Welcome to Story of Art. Today we will discuss Far Eastern Art, Part 3, Korean and Southeast Asian Art. In his book, The Story of Korean Art, Yo Hong-jun, professor of Myeongje University, says, Korean art has been much influenced by China from the formation of the ancient states to the 19th century. For that reason, our cultural identity has been doubted, and sometimes it leads to a cultural complex. But cultural influence doesn't naturally emerge. Rather, it is the result of aggressive choices by acceptors. The influence was not just offered by China, we chose to accept it. Archaeologists believe the Koreans descended from the nomadic Mongolian tribes that lived in North and Central Asia. Early Korean pottery from the 3rd millennium BC closely resembles Neolithic ceramics from Manchuria. Early bronze technology too was probably first introduced to Korea by Manchurians between 2000 and 1000 BC. Shamanism, a pervasive religion throughout much of Korea's history, probably also began at this time. After the Han Emperor Wu Di established a colony at Lolang near present-day Pyongyang in AD 108, Korea felt the impact of China most strongly. With the introduction of iron technology, the potter's wheel, Chinese writing, Buddhism, Confucianism, Chinese culture became firmly embedded on the Korean peninsula. The earliest potteries, dated to circa 7000 BC, were flat-bottomed wares, yan gi mun, and were decorated with relief designs, raised horizontal lines, and other impressions. This early period was followed by the art styles of various Korean kingdoms and dynasties. Korean artists sometimes modified Chinese traditions with a native preference for simple elegance, purity of nature, and spontaneity. From the 1st century BC until the 7th century, Korea was divided into three states. The kingdom of Koguryo in the north defeated the Chinese, but because of its geographical closeness to China, continued to be heavily influenced by Chinese culture. The kingdom of Paekchi in the southwest also maintained ties with China and, like Koguryo, adopted Buddhism in the 4th century. Buddhist sculptures produced during this time reflected styles prevalent in China's northern Wei dynasty. The kingdom of Silla in the southeast was slower to absorb Chinese culture and did not embrace Buddhism until the 6th century. In addition to these three centers of political power, several communities in the south central area of the Naktong River basin formed a federation of principalities known as the Kaya states. A notable aspect of Koguryo art is tomb murals that vividly depict everyday aspects of life in the ancient kingdom as well as its culture. Mural painting also spread to the other two kingdoms. These murals portrayed Buddhist themes and provide valuable clues about kingdom such as architecture and clothing. These murals were also the very beginnings of Korean landscape paintings and portraiture. Paekchi is considered the kingdom with the greatest art among the three states. Paekchi Buddhist culture is characterized by its naturalness, warmness, and harmonious proportions. Another notable feature is the use of the distinctive Paekchi smile, a mysterious and archaic smile that is characteristic of many Paekchi statues. While there are no surviving examples of wooden architecture, the Miruksa site holds the foundation stones of a destroyed temple and two surviving granite pagodas that show what Paekchi architecture may have looked. In 660, the Silla rulers allied their armies with forces from Shang China to defeat both Paekchi and Koguryo. The resulting unified Silla kingdom between 668 to 935 experienced a golden age, and its capital Gyeongju became one of Asia's greatest cities. Gold crowns remain as some of the more opulent objects from that time, as well as stoneware, jars and bowls on dramatic pedestals with geometric perforations. Two examples for the Buddhist art of this period are the Seokguram Grotto and Bulguksa Temple. Under Mongol domination in 1231, Korean subjects were forced to adopt Mongol customs, language and dress. Nevertheless, the Koryo dynasty between 918 to 1392 produced some of the finest cultural and artistic achievements in Korea's history. The capital of Kaesong was one of the world's most impressive cities. Koryo kings ordered the construction of hundreds of Buddhist temples and the creation of countless religious artworks. The most famous achievement, however, was to create ceramics with luminescent celadon glazes and delicate inlays. The rulers of the Yai or Joseon dynasty between 1392 to 1910 adopted Confucianism as their governing ideology and withdrew official support for Buddhism. During their reign, Confucianism's conservative ethics and values dominated Korea's social structure and attitudes. Like their Chinese counterparts, Korean scholars practiced the twin arts of calligraphy and painting. Rejecting the opulence of the previous Koryo dynasty, Yai potters made a coarse, informally decorated ware known as punch-ong, simple white porcelains inspired by the Chinese, also became popular during the early centuries of the Yai dynasty. And by the mid-15th century, white porcelains with blue, brown and red designs began to be produced as well. Unlike Chinese porcelains, however, Korean ceramics are known for their vigorous painting styles and whimsical designs. The decline of the strong Buddhist culture, which helped lead to a reduction in quality celadon products, also helped to move Korean painting away from its emphasis on religious motifs. In this period, a national painting style of landscapes called True View began, moving from the traditional Chinese style of idealist general landscapes to particular locations exactly rendered. The mid to late Joseon dynasty is considered the golden age of Korean painting. At the same time, as the interest in realistic landscapes surged, so did the practice of painting the realistic scenes of ordinary people doing ordinary things. Genre painting, as this has come to be called, is the most uniquely Korean of all the painting styles and gives us a historic look into the daily lives of the people of the Joseon period. Some of the most notable of the Genre painters were Kim Hong-do between 1745 to 1818, who left a large collection of paintings portraying many different scenes from Korea's past in vivid colors. Kim's works show ordinary people, male and female, young and old, engaged in everyday work or play. The figures are usually set against an empty or simplified background, so that it is the facial expressions and physical movements of the figures, along with the activity at hand, often involving the classroom, public sports or entertainment, or some type of manual labor, that become the focus of the picture. The paintings represent a moment in time, frozen, yet fully alive with all the sounds, actions and emotions. Kim's paintings are also often humorous, such as the scene of a boy being scolded by his teacher while his schoolmates giggle in the background, highlighting the light-hearted and playful side of life. Another of the great Shona painters was Shin Yun Bok, whose paintings often risk scenes were both romantic and sensual. Unlike Kim, Shin painted scenes of aristocrat scholars engaged in leisurely activities such as boating or listening to musical performances. In addition, he also well known for his pictures of courtesans known as Kiseng in Korea. Many of Shin's paintings involve a group of men on an outing with courtesans, semi-nude women bathing or laundering in the stream, or lovers' secret rendezvous, and are either subtly or overtly erotic. Minwa or folk paintings are by far the most interesting of the traditional Korean paintings. The characteristics of Minwa paintings are that they were all painted by unknown artists and all were painted near the end of or after the Joseon period. Though many of them appear rather childish and unrefined, quite a number display a great painting skill. Two schools of landscape painting were of particular importance during the Joseon period. One was led by the 15th century court artist An Kyon. His landscape paintings adapted and transformed stylistic and conceptual elements of the old northern song landscapes and perfected a unique style. He played with innovative and striking compositions that challenged conventional notions of space and time within painting. His distinctive brushstrokes were copied and adapted by his followers, who continued the tradition even after his time. The other major school or style of landscape painting arose in the 18th century, led by the master artist Chong Sun. His true view landscape style revolutionized the whole concept of landscape painting in Korea. The achievement of true view landscape painting lies in its ability to evoke the essence of both native landscape scenery and native sensibilities. Now, let us look into the art history of some other Southeast Asian regions which have maintained strong cultural bonds throughout its history with the three regions, China, Japan, and Korea, we have discussed. Art of Southeast Asia. The major influence that wielded these regions culturally was that of India. In the wake of Indian religious beliefs, Indian artistic styles spread to the South Asia and to the Indonesian islands. Buddhism was the first proselytizing religion. Styles which had originated in India acquired fresh vigor and developed quite independently, especially in Java and the territory of the Khmer Empire. Borobudur in central Java is one of the greatest masterpieces of Buddhist art. It was begun in about 825 under the Sailendra dynasty, who were probably of Indian extraction. The influence of stupas in North India is evident in its structure, as its nine terraces were built round the solid core of a natural hill. There is no interior apart from a sealed chamber in the crowning stupa, originally enclosing a statue of the Buddha. The form of stupa was multiplied rather than magnified. There are 72 small bell-shaped stupas encircling the main one. All contained statues of Buddha seated in the yogi pose and differing from one another only in the mudras or gestures of hands. The plan of the building, composed of four concentric circles girdled by squares which break forward in the center of each side, resembles a yantra or diagram used in Tantric Buddhism as an aid to meditation. Relief carvings which line the walls of rectangular terrace are more simply and overtly didactic, providing a kind of Buddhist pilgrim's progress from the illusory world to the ultimate reality. Despite the Indian origin of their subject matter, the symbolism and some of their forms, the carvings at Borobudur could hardly be mistaken for Indian works. Javanese facial features alone would set them apart. The history of visual arts of Cambodia stretches back centuries to ancient crafts. Khmer art reached its peak during the Angkor period. Traditional Cambodian arts and crafts include textiles, non-textile weaving, silversmithing, stone carving, lacquerware, ceramics, vat murals, and kite making. In Cambodian sculpture, the links with Indian art were equally residual, as in the combination of two Hindu gods, Vishnu and Shiva, in the Lide figure of Harihara from Prasat Andet, in 7th century. But a great change was brought about in the 8th century after the Khmer from the north occupied the whole Indo-Chinese peninsula. Khmer rulers alternated between Buddhism and Hinduism. The major artistic achievements of the Khmer were the great temples erected by and dedicated to the Devarajas or god kings. Angkor Wat, Temple of Capital, is the grandest of them and is probably the largest temple in the world. A mountain of carved stone rising to a height of some 200 feet, surrounded by covered passageways and a moat nearly 4 km in circumference. Let me conclude this session with the hope that you have got an overview of Far Eastern art, which is a vast area of study. Further, you may collect more details with the help of this module as a guideline. Summary: this study briefly describes about the major dynasties in Korean history, such as Kingdom of Koguryo, Kingdom of Paekshi, Kingdom of Silla, the Koryo dynasty, the Joseon dynasty, emphasizing the major trends of art and artists in each period. As far, Eastern is an umbrella term used to denote East and Southeast regions, which hold commonalities among its cultures' interests. A brief discussion about some of the major artistic monuments such as Borobudur and Angkor Wat is also included here. Prepare an essay on the monuments of Southeast Asia. Find out examples for contemporary Korean art and compare it with the traditional art of Korea. Hutt, Julia, Understanding Far Eastern Art, Oxford, Faden. Yo Hong Jun, The Story of Korean Art. Michael Sullivan, The Meeting of Eastern and Western Art. Rooney Don F., Angkor, Cambodia's Wondrous Khmer Temples. Hope you have enjoyed this session. We will discuss another topic in next session. Till then, bye.